as two new countries were being born in the Indian subcontinent. The leader of a Muslim-majority, Hindu-ruled kingdom of Kashmir, sat on the fence, hoping to make his state an independent country.
Let them wait.
When Governor-General Lord Mountbatten tried meeting him during his trip to Srinagar in June 1947,
"Tell Hari Sahib, Governor Mountbatten is here to see him. It is urgent."
Maharaja Hari Singh, the last of the Dogra rulers, avoided him.
"The Sardar is sick, Sahib. He has colic."
Signing a standstill agreement with Pakistan that sought time to decide, he avoided similar discussions with India, despite several letters exchanged between him and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Then jailed pro-India leader Sheikh Abdullah, Omar Abdullah's grandfather, during the crucial time of partition between May 1946 till end September 1947, so that he would not be a threat to him. And ignored Jinnah's several approaches through intermediaries even after Pakistan's independence on August 14, 1946.
"Salam, Raja Sahib. Mr. Jinnah has sent me with a message for you."
But events dictated fate instead. A rebuffed Pakistan stopped supplies of food, clothing and petrol to the landlocked state. On September 12th in Lahore, a meeting was held by Pakistan Prime Minister Liaquat Ali Khan to discuss an armed invasion of Kashmir.
"Khurshed Anwar, your Muslim League National Guard will be in charge of operations."
The Chief Minister of Northwest Frontier Province, Abdul Qayyum Khan, urged his people to war.
"The land of Kashmir is rightfully yours. The British have stopped you before, but now they are gone."
Meanwhile, the Pakistani army dangled a carrot in front of the Pashtun tribes as a way to self-finance the war.
"Whatever you can loot is yours."
Unbelievably, Anwar, instead of leading an armed force, left for his honeymoon instead, which required the original plan of a September invasion to be postponed for a month. Early on the morning of October 22, 1947, Pashtun tribesmen with Pakistani irregulars, led by senior officer Akbar Khan, entered Kashmir with the aim of a military victory. Marching unopposed to Muzaffarabad, they came upon Dogra troops of Raja Hari Singh, who, unprepared for such a large-scale invasion, could not defend the crucial bridge connecting Muzaffarabad and Domel. The news reached Srinagar, where the Maharaja had to be rudely awakened from his secured slumber.
"Sahib, Sahib, something terrible has happened."
Soon Garhi and Chinari fell as the main group proceeded towards Uri. Like the legendary and mythical Leonidas's 300, who held out against the Persian invader Xerxes I at Thermopylae, Greece in 480 BC. Similarly, another Indian hero, with only a small force numbering in the hundreds, got ready to face an army numbering in the thousands. Led by Brigadier Rajinder Singh, they fought to the last man and were ultimately martyred. Their sacrifice did not go in vain, as the battle gained enough time for the Union of India to come to the Maharaja's aid. While India prepared to send their troops, the invaders proceeded in boats, travelling down the Jhelum River towards Baramulla, the entry point into the Kashmir Valley. Jinnah was hopeful of a quick victory, assuming the Maharaja would capitulate easily.
"I will celebrate the October 26th in Srinagar."
But the Maharaja still had a phone-a-friend option. Dejected and demoralized, his dream of independence in tatters, he made his Hobson's choice.
"India, help me!"
The next day, India flew out its special envoy VP Menon to personally meet the Maharaja in Srinagar.
"I have come to ensure you and your family get out safely."
The king hurriedly left the valley by road to the safety of Jammu that very day, even as rumors swirled about that his convoy would be ambushed, leaving his palace unguarded and with no one left to defend the capital. But Menon also carried a message from India that day.
"We have got you out, but if you want India's help in warding off the invasion, you must join the Union of India."
According to Menon's memoirs, Integration of the Indian States, the king had by then already decided.
"My subjects and their properties would be safer with India."
The king had even decided something else the previous night after he had sent the letter of help to India.
"You are my trusted servant. If India does not send any troops in 2 days, you must shoot me in my sleep.
I must never be captured alive." Even before the Maharaja had agreed to join India, the Defense Committee of India was unanimous in their opinion.
"Pakistan must be foiled immediately."
At the crack of dawn on October 27, 1947, the 1st Battalion of Sikh Regiment, led by Lieutenant Colonel Dewan Ranjit Pai, was flown into Srinagar from where he rushed to Baramulla. In the fierce fight that followed, he lost his life, but they had succeeded in halting their advance.
Governor General Mountbatten frowned upon India sending troops into a neutral state, as he felt that it would lead to another round of bloodletting.
It is the height of folly.
It was only when the Raja signed the Treaty of Accession to India that Mountbatten was pacified, though he insisted on a rider.
Troops may be stationed there on a temporary basis until a referendum is held.
So ended the Dogra dynasty of Kashmir, which the founder Gulab Singh had bought from the British for a princely sum of 75 lakhs, about $100,000. After the great Sikh ruler Maharaja Ranjit Singh died, the British took over his empire during the years of 1848-49 as Gulab Singh stood aside, unable or unwilling to fight them. But the British still had a problem. From the far reaches of Afghanistan till the Sultanate in Delhi stretched a Muslim corridor. Wanting to impede this corridor, they installed a pliant Hindu ruler over its Muslim population, thus rewarding Gulab Singh for his inaction. Meanwhile, Menon returned to Delhi the next day with the instrument of accession, which was accepted by the Cabinet Defense Committee, who declared,
"Kashmir accedes to India. A referendum will be held in the state when the law and order situation allows it."
Former Kashmir Prime Minister N. Gopalaswamy Iyengar was appointed to look after Kashmir affairs and was one of the chief architects of Article 370. To secure Kashmir's accession, Nehru appointed the Maharaja's sworn enemy Sheikh Abdullah as emergency administrator of the state. The appointment of a pro-India administrator made Jinnah furious and he ordered his acting army chief, General Sir Douglas Gracie,
"I want the entire Pakistan army to march into Srinagar and capture it."
During the handover period from Britain, the supreme commander of both armies was Field Marshal Auchinleck, who rushed over to Lahore from Delhi to persuade Jinnah to withdraw his order.
"We're sorry, Mr. Jinnah, but we cannot allow that to happen."
With his Srinagar dream over, Jinnah changed tack. In a meeting in Lahore between Lord Mountbatten and the two governor-generals of the countries, India for the first time made their offer to Pakistan.
"We are ready to hold a plebiscite immediately.
If it is held while Abdullah is still in charge, the people will surely vote for India."
"No, it will be held under the supervision of both our governor-generals."
No agreement was reached and Nehru appealed to Britain's Prime Minister Clement Attlee.
"Kindly use your influence over Pakistan and ask them to call off their aggression in Jammu and Kashmir."
But the British Prime Minister refused to intervene.
"I suggest you use proper channels like the United Nations. I'm sure they will be able to deal with it ably."
As the new year broke on January 1, 1948, Pandit Nehru raised the issue with United Nations. On January 13, 1948, the UN passed a resolution that outlined three sequential steps. First, Pakistan was to withdraw all troops from the newly occupied region. After which, India were to withdraw all its troops from all of Jammu and Kashmir. Only after both these steps was a plebiscite to be held. By the time the Karachi Agreement of 27 July 1949 was signed, that established the ceasefire line and brought a formal end to the war, India had driven out Pakistani troops from most of its territory. In the first assembly elections held in Jammu and Kashmir in 1951, Sheikh Abdullah's National Conference suspiciously won each and every seat and, as guaranteed by the instrument of accession, became its prime minister. In complete control, soon power went to Sheikh Abdullah's head and he started to believe,
"I could make Kashmir an independent country."
His resolve increased when Adlai Stevenson, who had run for United States president the previous year, visited Kashmir in 1953.
"If you were to become independent, the United States would support it."
When this news reached Nehru, Karan Singh, the son of Maharaja Hari Singh, now an active congressman,
"I, the current Sardar-e-Riyasat of Jammu and Kashmir, under the powers vested in me, hereby dismiss Sheikh Abdullah from his position of Prime Minister."
Abdullah found himself jailed once again, this time for 11 long years in what came to be known as the Kashmir conspiracy case. Bakshi Ghulam Mohammad became the new Prime Minister, but his family's penchant for taking a cut from every government project led his government to be called BBC, Bakshi Brothers Corporation. As India went about its business of nation building, Kashmir slowly warmed to India's democratic process. But it was the 1987 state elections, rigged by Rajiv Gandhi, that decisively turned the tide towards militancy, where candidates on the ballot box like Syed Salahuddin were turned into militants by being jailed and denied their electoral victories. India had at least two golden opportunities to remove Article 370. The first time in 1972, after the surrender of Pakistan's army in Dhaka during the creation of Bangladesh. The then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, to prove her secular credentials, decided to be magnanimous and give back 93,000 Pakistani prisoners of war in exchange for nothing. In fact, Indira is reported to have reached an understanding with Sheikh Abdullah.
You give up the demand for a plebiscite and we will continue with Article 370.
Then again in 1990, when VP Singh was Prime Minister and Kashmiri Pandits were being driven out from their homes in the valley, changing the status quo explicitly against what 370 stood for. Geographically, under the concept of partition along religious lines, Kashmir should have gone to Muslim Pakistan, but for its Hindu ruler. The takeover of Kashmir was started by Nehru, but finished by Modi's BJP.
Bisbo's limerick. The history of Kashmir is full of twists and turns. It's a period of time that was full of churns. How the Raja acceded and India succeeded. But it's still not the peace for which every Kashmiri yearns.
Subscribe to Bisbo's channel and be sure to click on the bell icon. Be the first to know when Bisbo releases a new video.